On the outskirts of a nameless Russian town in the middle of the 19th century, a carriage is flying through the night. Its driver lashing the horses as if he were running from the very devil himself. And it's raining.
Oh, thank you very much.
The carriage's leather blinds were pulled down. No light could be seen inside. Its occupant remained a mystery. The only evidence of his existence was the sound of a cane thumping the underside of the carriage roof and the constantly shouted command.
Onward! Onward!
Indeed, as the carriage turned onto the main road into the town, two wheelwrights were heard to say, "Upon my soul, now who could that be?"
Upon my soul! Now who could that be?
The carriage had stopped outside an inn. Its side door opened and out stepped a man. Not too thin, not too fat, not ugly, but not all that pleasant to look at either.
You take the bags in there, I'll speak to the proprietor.
His hair a middling shade of dull brown.
Do you mind? No, no, you can stable the horses afterwards. The bags!
An insipid pallor to his skin, his teeth dull and yellowing, a faint odour of...
Yes, thank you.
His tailcoat was attempting to be fashionable. His trousers, cream-coloured and unflatteringly tight.
How did he get in here?
Good evening, sir.
Evening it is, my fine fellow, but is it good?
What?
I said evening it... No, it doesn't matter. I'm looking for a room.
Certainly, sir. If I could just have your name?
Chichikov.
Bless you, sir.
What?
Your name, sir.
Chichikov.
Bless you, sir.
No.
I'm afraid the police are very insistent. I will need a name.
Chichikov.
Always going three, don't they, sir? Bless you again.
No, I think he's trying to say he's called Chichikov.
Why on earth would he want to do that?
It's because it's my name. I am Chichikov.
As you wish, sir.
The innkeeper was a tubby, portly, ruddy-faced man that suggested one or two nights spent with only a bottle of port for company.
Friend of yours, is he?
Nope, never met him before.
Well, if you would sign the register.
Certainly. Right now. I must say, it's rather a relief to see another human face after so long travelling across some of the most benighted Ukrainian flatlands.
What's that funny smell?
Oh, I can't smell anything.
2 days confined in a carriage had certainly done little for the stranger's personal odour.
It's not me.
Here on business, are we, sir?
Business? Yes, I think you could call it that. Let's just say I have a small transaction to effect with a number of the local landowners. tell me, there are several large estates in the vicinity.
Certainly there are, sir.
It's very good, very good. And the lands are worked by good quantities of peasant labour, I suppose.
As in all Russia, yes, sir.
It's capital. And I dare say that this area is not immune to the regular outbreaks of cholera and typhus.
Indeed, sir. Only last year I lost my dear old mother to that cruel disease.
Excellent. Well, this seems ideal. I should be glad to be your guest. Now then, I should like a morning room and an evening room, and a bedroom. And a dressing room. I require the sun in the morning, but have no use for it in the day. My bath must be exclusively for my use, and if possible, I should like to eat behind a screen. My driver is stabling his horses just now, but he will also need somewhere to lay his head.
Very good. And a room for this gentleman?
Who?
Oh, thank you very much.
No.
Oh.
I know who he is. I told you.
I don't have an east-facing room, I'm afraid.
Oh, dear.
Nor a morning room.
Oh, well, I can make do.
Nor a dressing room. Nor a private bath, for that matter.
Oh, well.
An evening room would be difficult to arrange. The sun rises and sets where it will, and you'll eat at a table like everyone else.
So, a bedroom, then?
Certainly. And your man can sleep with the horses.
Oh, no, thank you.
No, not you.
I'll instruct him to bring your bags to your rooms. If you would step this way, Mr...
Chichikov.
Well, I never.
Well, it's actually a very old Slavic name.
Later that evening, having dined modestly on cabbage soup and sweet pastry, just a couple of sausages, and the smallest serving of brains with peas available to him, a roasted fowl, some more cabbage, and a trifling handful of salted cucumbers, washed down with what he was told was wine, he undid his waistcoat buttons and returned happily to his room. Focusing with difficulty, he wrote into his pocketbook the names of the town governor, the head of the Chamber of Commerce, and sundry other pieces of information acquired during dinner. And with that, he closed his eyes and drifted immediately into sleep, snoring for all the world like some kind of farm animal.
I wasn't snoring.
Oh, you were.
No, I wasn't even asleep.
You were too.
No, I wasn't.
Yes, you were.
No, I wasn't. No back answer, so...
And with those words, our hero closed his eyes and prepared for a good night's sleep.
Would you get out of my bed, please?
Oh, right. Next morning, Chichikov paid a visit to each of the various dignitaries whose names he had so cunningly extracted from the houseman. To each he had prepared a different mode of introduction. To the inspector of the medical board, he complimented the health of the townsfolk.
We do our best, Mr...
Chichikov.
Mr. Chichikov. Or is it doctor?
Oh, please, just Chichikov.
To the chief of police, he railed sympathetically at drunkenness.
Ah...
To the liquor franchisee, he bought a bottle of aged turnip vodka. The director of factories, he inadvertently called Your Excellency.
Thank you.
The Archbishop, he mistakenly called Your Holiness.
Bless you.
By the time he met the Vice-Governor, his compliments had become quite extravagant.
There is a quality to the air and water here that is quite unlike any other town in the whole of the world.
And by the time he met the Governor, they'd become wholly implausible.
When my carriage first entered your town, I had the oddest sensation that I was entering paradise and that the wheels were rolling on a carpet of velvet.
I think I can be justifiably proud of my road maintenance programme.
Nonetheless, by lunchtime, Chichikov's name was a sweet taste on the lips of all the town's leaders. And he returned to his lodgings with pockets filled with invitations to dinner and, most importantly, a letter of introduction.
Is my carriage ready, Selifan?
Ready and waiting, sir.
Good. Have it brought round to the front.
Where are we going, sir?
Well, while you spent a lazy morning luxuriating in the sights and smells of a rural Russian stable yard, I managed to acquire an introduction to one of the greatest and most noble men of the district, a man of land and distinction, a man by the name of Andrei Vasilievich Manilov.
And why are we going there? What?
I said,
uh-huh.
I'm being mysterious.
Yeah, but if you're mysterious...
So we leave in 10 minutes.
The conveyance bumped uncomfortably along a badly kept road, and after thumping his head twice on the roof of the carriage...
Ow!
Chichikov mentally penned a stern letter to the town governor. And then, remembering his comments about the velvet roads, mentally tore it up again.
Onward! Faster! Come on, onward!
The featureless scrublands of Western Russia hurried by the carriage windows. Hummocks, fir groves, stunted, scrawny young pines, the dead stumps of old... Why did you close the window?
I'm trying to think.
But I'm doing description. I'm being vivid.
Well, it's not vivid, it's boring.
Oh, how wounding.
I'm just saying...
No, don't worry about me.
I just want a little bit of peace and quiet.
Oh, fine, fine. I won't say another word.
I don't mean to be rude.
It's fine. I won't say anything until we reach Manilov's estate.
Well, thank you.
The carriage pulled up at Manilov's estate. The estate's owner came out to meet them at the door.
My dear friend, esteemed monsieur. I hope you will not take it amiss if I say that we are deeply honoured by your presence on our modest estate. No, curse my foolishness and dash that word from your mind. Merely honoured? No, I do you a grave injustice, sir, a grave injustice. A man of your ostentatious accomplishments, permit me at least to say, sir, that the Manilov estate welcomes you as a brother. As a friend, as a guest, as a lord, as a companion of honour and a knight of the garter, as a thing of light and air and a creature of the vasty deeps. You would do me, sir, the greatest honour with which it will have been my fortune to have been blessed if you would follow me to my sitting room.
Right. I take it you received the governor's letter?
What did it say?
Indeed, I did, dear friend, indeed I did. And if I should tell you that ever I received a finer compliment than your visit, then may you denounce me and publish the opinion abroad that Andrei Vasilievich Manilov is a liar. A liar, sir.
Andrei Vasilievich Manilov was not a liar. But he was probably the most mind-bogglingly tedious man in the whole of Russia.
Mm-hmm. Do me the honour of making yourself at home, sir.
Oh, thank you.
Don't sit there, dear friend.
What?
The seat covers are in need of repair.
Ah.
Nor there, for that matter, my dear sir.
Look.
The one by the window.
What?
The one by the window.
Right. Thank you.
An excellent choice, dear friend. The finest chair in the room. I hope you will not think me amiss, dear sir, if I assert that it was the exquisiteness of your soul that drew you there.
You are very kind.
No, indeed, I am not.
Well, may I say that you are?
No, sir, I forbid it.
Sir, do permit me to insist that you are, after all, very kind.
Permit me not to permit you, esteemed guest. Kind, I am not.
Right.
Would your friend care to sit down?
Oh, rather.
No, he's fine.
As you wish, revered visitor.
Is he not actually my friend?
I'll just stand in the corner, then.
Just travels with me.
No, don't worry about me.
Don't know why.
Lucky thing to accompany such a miracle among men.
You must have a considerable acreage on this estate?
I can see I'm in the presence of a man of acute perception. Mm. I do indeed have a considerable acreage.
Must take quite some tending, I should think.
You are precisely right, dear friend. Quite some tending indeed.
And rather a lot of serfs to pay the soul tax on.
Away with you, magician. Oh. Did you not come with the governor's personal recommendation, I would suspect you of espionage. I do indeed have rather a lot of serfs.
Ah. Tell me, dear sir, were your serfs badly affected by the typhus outbreak this last winter?
Ah, indeed, sir. Several of the souls in my possession passed on in that terrible, terrible winter.
Really, really? Mm. How many? Roughly. Or exactly?
I've no idea. Quite a number. May one inquire what interest my revered friend has in such matters?
Oh, just idle curiosity, you know, a certain humanitarian interest.
I must demand that you forgive my impertinence in asking.
Just, it is one of the many burdens of land that one must still pay tax on the serfs in one's possession, even after they've passed on.
It is.
And then there are, after all, another 8 years until the next census. 8 more years of tax for the privilege of having a peasant work your land, even when he is, shall we say, no longer available for work.
One rails at the injustice, but what can one do?
Exactly. Well, indeed. I might be able to help you there.
You might?
Yes.
How?
Well, I could buy your peasants from you.
Buy my peasants? My serfs? But you know that I need them to work the land.
No, not those ones. No, the dead ones. I want to buy the dead ones.
Forgive me, best and most beloved of all possible guests, but I'm not sure I understand you.
Well, I propose that we draw up a deed by which I take legal possession of all those souls who have died since the last census. Which bit of this aren't you getting?
Do you mean to say that you want a deed of purchase for my dead serfs?
There's no need to announce on the deed that they're dead. I think it wise, indeed, in the fullest sense, most respectful of the law, to carry them on the deed of purchase, just as they are on the census. See, that is, as living.
Ah!
And with that, Manilov tilted his head to one side and pursed his lips. It was an expression he'd once seen on the face of a government minister, and it had impressed him as a most intelligent way of arranging one's features. He'd mentally resolved to do likewise, should the appropriate situation arise. The situation had just arisen.
Sorry he does this.
On Manilov's face, however, the expression implied intestinal difficulties.
He's not my friend.
You will forgive me for wondering what the summit of all humankind, may I say, your sublime self, would gain from such an arrangement. It appears to me that you are offering to pay a considerable sum in tax while gaining nothing of any value in return.
Nothing of value? What, dear friend, have I failed to convey what it means to me to know your hospitality? Your friendship, your conversation. Shut up. I am a stranger in these lands, and yet you have welcomed me in as a friend. Is it too much to imagine that I might wish to do you some small service in return?
Permit large salty tears to run down this old face, dearest and most celestial of acquaintances.
Oh, there's permission granted, dear friend. It remains only to agree a price for these souls.
A price? A price? Kick these old legs from under me if I even contemplate setting you a price.
Away
with you and your price. I shall give you these poor souls. And what is more, I shall pay the notary fees myself.
Oh, my God. Oh, my goodness me.
I am a sentimental old fool, sir, and run me through with a beef skewer if I say otherwise.
Goodbye.
There can be nothing good in parting from such an exemplar of all that is noble and fine.
Still, cheerio. Onward.
Watch out for those clouds. They seem nasty.
Will do.
Though would they dare open on such a man? Man, did I say? A divinity, rather. A spirit from another world sent to us in human form.
But Chichikov was not listening. Instead, he stared at the list of dead serfs prepared by Manilov's steward. 246 names, printed neatly on several sheets of stiff cartridge paper. His plan was proving easier than he could have imagined. It had formed in his mind 2 years beforehand and developed in months of careful planning. Chichikov's idea was to...
So what are you doing?
I'm explaining your plan.
I can do that.
You can't explain it.
I can explain it better than you can.
I don't think so.
Well, I'm going to.
Well, not if I explain it first.
Look, I thought of it first.
Well, so what?
Well, it's my plan, so I get to explain it.
Well, when did that become a rule?
You ask me the questions, I'll answer them.
Okay.
Right. First, you need to know that there's a census every 10 years.
And would I be right in thinking that the number of serfs you have at the time of the census determines how much tax you have to pay every year for the next 10 years?
That's not a real question, is it? It's just that is just a disguised explanation.
Sorry.
Well, in essence, you're right, yes. But if a serf dies a year after the census, you have to keep paying tax for the next 9 years.
How does that help you?
Well, if I can persuade these landowners to transfer ownership of these dead serfs to me...
They won't have to pay the tax anymore.
But, you're asking, what do I stand to gain?
What do you have to gain, Pavel Ivanovich?
Good question, because this is where it becomes brilliantly clever.
Sounds exciting. Tell me more.
Well, there are certain financial institutions that loan money.
Banks?
Yes, I know. And if I can go to them with 1,000 serfs...
1,000?
Yeah, absolutely. They won't consider anything less.
Piddling small change.
It's hardly worth having.
Waste of time.
Well, yes.
Don't come in here with your 41 serfs.
Shut up.
And what do you get for your 1,000 serfs?
Now, with a security of 1,000 serfs, they will loan me 50,000 rubles. And in 9 years' time, when I fail to repay the loan, they take possession of my security.
The dead serfs?
Yes, they keep the serfs, I keep the money. 50,000 rubles, think of it. What's that for?
No, nothing great. Good plan.
No, come on, spit it out.
Well, it's just... Don't get me wrong, it's a bit unsporting.
The most brilliant con trick of the 19th century, and you, Mr. Uninvited... Stupid head, you think it's unsporting?
There's no need to get petty about it. I was just saying.
Well, don't, all right?
Okay, fine. Forget I said anything.
Good.
As Manilov had warned, the skies opened and soon sheets of rain were lashing the side of the coach.
Now, you see, that's petty.
And soon it became equally obvious that the driver had got himself completely lost.
What's going on?
Beg pardon, sir?
What happened to the road?
I don't know what you mean, sir.
This is a field.
No, this is a road, sir.
No, it isn't. It's a ploughed field.
Is it?
Yes, it is, actually.
Well, it's possible, I suppose.
Turn back. We can rejoin the road over there.
Right you are, sir.
No, not like that. You'll tip us over.
No, don't worry about that, sir. She's steady as a rock, this one. Look out!
Now, that is not supposed to happen with this model.
In fact, this was a well-known design fault with the Model T Imperial Britska and would lead to it being withdrawn from sale 5 years after the events of this story.
You drunken idiot!
Drunk, sir?
Oh!
My word of honour, sir, is it so wrong to break a little bread, sir? Oh. That's all it was, sir. Break a little bread with a good man, sir. No. Good bread with a good man and a little drop of something to wash it down. Is it so wrong, sir?
Just look at me!
Oh, that'll wash off in the rain.
Oh, smashing!
I can see you're upset, sir, and I would be too. If it'd make you feel better, perhaps you'd better teach me a lesson. I deserve to be punished, sir. Beat me!
Well, you're very, very lucky I don't.
Thrash me, sir! Beat me black and blue! I turned over your carriage. I am no good. I need to be beaten!
No, no, I'm...
First the whip, and then the stick!
No, no, really. I'm...
And then you can ask in that big house there if they have a hot poker that they'd lend you to shove right on
that. That won't be necessary, Cellophane.
What? What did you say? A hot poker to shove right on that...
No, what big house?
Over there, end of the field, sir.
Sobakevich's estate. That must be it. Come on, let's go. We can pick the carriage up in the morning.
You want me to walk across the field?
Absolutely, 5 minutes, that's all.
In these shoes?
Oh, come on!
Eventually, after trudging over the field for about a day...
Don't exaggerate.
Well, it was almost an hour.
It was half an hour at most.
Everyone in galoshes except Muggins here.
After trudging over a field, we came
That's
to
my line.
Yeah, well, get on with it. Stop moaning.
I mean, where did you get galoshes?
After trudging across a field, we came to...
We came to a large wooden door. I could get foot rot or something.
Hello? Who's that?
I told you I'd get us here, didn't I? And here we are.
Hello. Is Sobakevich at home?
Sobakevich?
Yes, your master.
I don't have a master, sir.
Of course you do. Who owns this house?
The mistress, sir.
The mistress. So, Cellophane, you got us there, did you? Well, would you fetch her, please?
It's very late.
Yes, I know it's late. Would you kindly tell her that a traveller is... Tell her a traveller...
A businessman.
Yeah, a wealthy businessman travelling with his...
retinue.
Retinue requests a place to rest his head.
You're covered in mud.
Yes, we had a small accident.
Who else have you got there?
How do?
Hello.
What's wrong with your feet?
Don't get me started.
Would you fetch your mistress, please?
You wait here, sir.
I said I got us here, sir, didn't I? You be my witness, and I have got us here. Only here isn't there, that's the only thing. If there was here, then I'd have said I got us there, but I got us
Shut
here.
Up, you are an idiot.
Can't disagree, sir.
So what is this place?
Somewhere warm, I hope. I need to dry my socks.
Oh, do stop moaning!
Hello?
Good evening, madam.
My man tells me you are a gentleman of affairs.
My name is Chichikov, dear lady. I and my retinue...
Hello.
Hello.
...had an unfortunate accident in this dreadful weather, and we would be most grateful...
Oh, of course, do come in. Dmitri, take these gentlemen's coats.
Yes, madam.
Thank you so much, my dear madam...
Korobotchka,
you are certainly an angel sent from heaven.
Oh, not at all, my pleasure. Now, I imagine what you'd like is a nice hot bath.
Oh, lovely.
Oh, wouldn't we all? Can't get the stove to work. I haven't had a hot bath since my husband died.
Oh, I am sorry to hear that.
Oh, not at all. The sorrow has finally passed, I'm pleased to say.
I'm most glad. And how long have you lived here alone, may I ask?
Oh, let me see now. Mr. Korobotchik would have died, must be 2 weeks ago. Now, what you gentlemen would like, I imagine, is a nice hot meal before bed.
Well, that would be...
We got nothing in, weren't expecting visitors.
I quite understand, my dear lady. It's been a long day, and perhaps after a good sleep we could continue this charming conversation in the morning.
And indeed, a manservant prepared us all a lovely bed, which was a bit of a squeeze, but very comfortable nonetheless.
Now, is there anything I can have my man bring you up?
No.
Oh, because it's no trouble.
No, please don't give us another thought, dear lady.
I must say it's very nice to have a proper gentleman staying in the house. I haven't had a gentleman in this house since poor Mr. Korobotchik died.
In the whole 2 weeks?
Not a one. Will you require another blanket?
No, thank you. No.
And what about you, dear sir? Would you like me to tickle your feet?
I'm sorry?
Mr. K would never get to sleep without a little tickling of the feet.
Well, you are inordinately kind, dear sweet lady, but I think I shall go without.
You're sure now?
Yes, absolutely.
Oh, well. Good night, then.
Good night.
This corridor can be draughty. Would you like the door open or closed?
Closed, I think.
Of course. Well, good night, then.
Yes, good night. Perhaps you would close it after you've gone out?
Oh, of course, dear sir, as you wish. Well, good night, then. Yes.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Night.
And soon the room was quiet and still, disturbed only by the sound of Chichikov's bestial snoring.
Go to sleep.
Light streamed into the small back bedroom, and Chichikov gazed in wonder at the estate revealed so spectacularly by the morning sun.
I see you're gazing in wonder at the estate revealed so spectacularly by the morning sun. Did I startle you?
I thought I'd lock the door, that's all.
Have my way.
Oh, this is charming.
I came to tell you that my girl has laid out breakfast for you.
Oh, good.
When you're ready to come down.
Yes, certainly. Just finish my ablutions.
I'll be waiting for you, Mr. Cheeky Chops.
Right. What?
Oh, in the dining room, a terrific spread. Sorry, I wasn't expecting.
That's better. I'll start again. In the dining room, a terrific spread was laid out for breakfast. Mushrooms, baked pies, dumplings, cheese tarts, doughnuts, pancakes, fritters with onion, fritters with poppy seeds, fritters with anchovies, and best of all, fritters with curds.
Fritters with curds? Where?
Oh.
You greedy pig.
Do help yourself, my dear Mr. Cheeky Chops.
Oh, magnificent. Don't leave me alone with her. Good Lord, egg pie?
Yeah.
Sounds delicious.
No, thank you.
I hope you won't mind if I steal Mr. Cheeky Chops away from you.
Not at all.
Oh, dear.
I understand you're in business, Mr. Cheeky Chops.
That's quite right, madam, in a manner of speaking.
You see, now I'm cursing myself that I sold my honey to the merchants. I'm sure you would have bought it from me.
Well, actually...
And I suppose you'll be wanting hemp. But I'm afraid I've sold most of that, too.
Oh, dear.
I have perhaps half a pood.
Half a...
pood.
Goodness.
However, I will simply not let you leave here with only my semi-pood. I must have something you wish to buy.
Tell me, madam, your serfs, your peasants, how are they?
How are they?
Yes, I mean to say, have you suffered much loss in their numbers?
Oh, yes, sir. Incalculably, sir, incalculably. Why, only yesterday my blacksmith exploded.
Exploded?
Oh, and he was such a good blacksmith, too.
Oh, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. So you've really been hit hard, haven't you? Oh, dear. Oh, what a shame. Oh, the injustice. Well, why not let me have them?
Let you have them? Oh, you must try a pancake or two. Dip them in the melted butter, my dear sir.
Yes, thank you, later. Let me have them, Mrs. Korobotchka.
Oh, call me Natasha. You wouldn't have me dig them out of the ground, would you, dear sir? Have a flan.
No. I would merely take ownership of them on paper.
You do know they're dead.
Yes,
Yes, I know they're dead.
Dead as mutton, sir. They're not coming back.
Yes, yes, yes. I know what dead means.
And you want them?
Yes.
I've never sold a dead person before.
Well, no, of course you haven't, you see. But how could a dear, sweet, charming lady like yourself have had occasion to sell a dead person?
In any case, who's to say that having a dead peasant about the place might not come in handy in an emergency?
Chichikov wanted to say,
"You are an idiot."
Instead, he said,
"I do understand your concerns.
Perhaps you would rather buy some lard."
"No, no, I really don't want to buy some lard. I want to buy your dead serfs."
"What's wrong with my lard?"
"Nothing, nothing, nothing is wrong with your..."
"I know that my lard is spoken of in hushed tones."
"I have no doubt."
"It has a smoky sweetness that is the envy of the district."
"And when I return, I shall sing its praises to the governor. Now, please..."
"You know the town governor?"
"I do indeed, madam. Indeed, I dined with him and his delightful wife only 2 days ago."
"Oh, well, why did you not say so, my dear sir? Why, of course, you may take possession of my old serfs."
"Well, I thank you, madam."
"I think a nice round 15 rubles will be a suitable sum."
15 rubles?
"Well, it would seem a reasonable sum."
"Well, I might say, madam, that Manilov was kind enough to give me his souls without charge."
"Manilov did?"
"Well, never mind, no matter. 15 rubles it is."
"Oh, and I would be very grateful to you, dear sir, if you would ballyhoo my flans to the governor."
"Consider them ballyhooed."
And Mrs. Korobotchka dictated the names of all her lost souls to Chichikov, who folded the list up neatly, thanked her effusively, and set off contentedly in the carriage.
18. And all that fuss for 18 serfs.
Every little helps.
I paid 15 rubles for these corpses.
And makes 264.
She's a swindler, that's what she is.
Only 736 to go.
Sobikevich better have a good haul, that's all I'm saying.
736 till the big 1,000.
And look at these names. Look, what, Alexandra the Glazier, Bobik the Builder. I mean, she's making them up. Look at this one. Yuri, take your hat off.
Why have we stopped?
Oh, yes. Right, onward, Selifan! Onward!
I can hear voices.
Oh, look, take a look outside, see what the problem is.
The carriage had stopped because facing it on the narrow rural road was another carriage. So far in this tale, I've not dwelt upon the lower class of character. I'm perfectly aware of how repellent such ordinary folk are to decent people, and I hesitate to introduce them even now, but with the two carriages squared up to one another, a battle of wits ensued.
"Didn't you hear me shouting? I told you to move to the f***ing right!"
In the course of the debate that followed, these low fellows, I regret to say, used the full resources of the Russian language. Mindful, however, that there may be ladies attending this tale, I shall do my best to spare their blushes.
"No, why don't you move to the f***ing left, you son of a... You drunk old... Just you come over here and say that."
"Drunk, am I? You say that again, you little...
Just move your... little of a coach and let the big boys through.
Just you try it, you fat...
Right, you asked for this."
Taking Selifan at his word, the coachman marshalled his horses and drove straight at his rival's carriage, veering to the left only at the last minute.
Whew, that was a close one.
"I can't open the door."
"What?"
"It doesn't look very pretty from out here."
"Selifan!"
"Need a new paint job, please."
"Afternoon."
"What have you done to my coach?"
"Terrible, innit? If I catch the dirty little... I'll give him a piece of my mind."
"You haven't got enough to spare. That's all I need. In this kind of work, you have to be unobtrusive. You know, in, out, that's the plan. Gone before they know what's hit them. And thanks to Selifan, I now have the most recognisable carriage in Europe. Can you get us to a coaching house?"
"In no time. We'll ride like the wind, sir."
And indeed we did, if the wind were a third-hand carriage with a scrape down one side and a broken door, driven by a drunken Ukrainian. But, true to his word, he found an inn, where Chichikov went incognito.
Good afternoon, landlord. My name's... it's Jim.
Just visiting, are we?
Yes. And I work for a... it's a big shop.
good for you, sir.
Could I have some beer, please?
Certainly, sir. Yes,
I drink beer. You see, that's the kind of man I am.
Brilliant. You're now completely undercover.
Oh, my lord.
What is it?
It's Nozdryov. I met him at the governor's house. Hide me.
Too late.
Oh. Well, 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 look who it isn't. I spy with my little eye something beginning with C. Chichikov!
Hello.
Not often you get that kind of welcome, eh?
Well, no, it isn't.
Get these in, will you? I lost every last cent I had at cards.
Oh, dear.
I had to sell my carriage.
And how much did you lose?
6 or 7.
It's not so bad, is it?
100.
Kopecks.
Rubles. Kopecks are for babies.
Nozdryov was an inveterate liar, infamous around the Ukraine for his pointless pretenses.
I once had a bright blue horse, you know.
His absurd exaggerations.
Yesterday, I jumped over that barn.
His meaningless boast.
I can kill a man with a pair of shoes.
Oh, really?
I have the power of second sight.
Oh, that's interesting.
I am immune to all known diseases.
Very handy.
Only last year, cholera swept one way across my estate, typhus the other. Servants dropping around me. Oh. Did I cough once the entire winter? No, sir.
Oh, well, lucky old you. Wait a minute. What did you say? Did you say you have an estate?
Chichikov quickly discovered that Nozdryov did indeed have an estate. He also discovered that this estate was larger than China and was looked after only by girly men.
Here's to us. Aye. Manly men, not girly men.
Your health.
Your health.
And as they drank, Chichikov explained his usual proposition.
Why do you want them?
Why do you care?
It's pretty fishy.
I want merely as a friend to relieve you of the burden of taxation.
Priceless, priceless. You should go on the stage.
Oh, all right, well, and you mustn't tell anybody, but I have worked out a scheme where I can use these dead serfs as securities against a loan of 50,000 rubles. You see, when the time comes to repay, I default, hand them my dead serfs as security, leaving me 50,000 rubles the richer.
I've never heard such a pack of lies in my life.
It's the truth.
Why would you go to so much trouble?
That's what I said.
Well, look, what does it matter? Just give me the souls. What are you doing?
Do you want a deal?
No, what are you doing with the cards?
So we can play for my serfs.
Why can't you just give me them?
Well, I virtually am. You've seen my luck at cards.
No.
See, look, the nine of clubs. Oh, you devil of a card, will I never be free of you?
No, I'm not playing cards with you.
I used to think you were decent. Now I see that you are a girly man.
I am not a girly man.
Yes, you are as girly as a man can be.
Just give me the serf.
Not a hope.
You are a fool, sir.
You take that back.
No, I certainly shall not.
Well, I shall make you.
Wait, no, don't stop it. Don't put the gun down.
Who's the fool now?
I just wanted the serf.
Tell me, who's the fool now, sir?
Which one of you is Mr. Nozdryov?
Me, and who's asking?
I'm an officer with the Imperial Guard with a warrant for your arrest.
Arrest what for?
Shooting at the Landover Mr. Makasimov while under a state of intoxication.
Nonsense. I don't even have a gun.
What's that in your hand, sir?
Oh, well, this is a gun, yes. Oh, thank the Lord! I managed to snatch it from the hand of this gentleman who... Where did he go?
Onward! Onward!
While Nozdryov's attention was distracted, the landlord had ushered us through the coal cellar and out to the safety of the carriage. As Chichikov ruminated on his lucky escape, he had cause also to observe that in all other matters, luck had turned against him. The easy success at Manilov's had turned into the poor return from Korobotchka and nothing at all from Nozdryov. Looking from the window, he watched in the distance as another carriage made its lonely way through the fading light of a Ukrainian evening. A single lamp burned within the carriage, and Chichikov watched it trace a journey past stumps and hedges. Where was it going, Chichikov would never know. Who was its occupant? What journey were they undertaking? For what purpose? What Chichikov did not know was that the carriage contained the widow Korobotchka, and her destination was the estate at Manilov. Since his departure, a terrible suspicion had grown in her mind.
Oh, terrible, terrible!
The thought that she had perhaps been swindled out of something truly valuable had become unbearable.
Oh, exactly. Unbearable.
Although the encounter between Korobotchka and Manilov would eventually cause Chichikov no small trouble, his fortunes were about to lift, though it did not appear so at the beginning.
Oh, you're him? The man that fool of a governor wrote to me about?
Yes.
And who's this long drink of water?
I'm nobody.
What's wrong with your leg?
I forgot my galoshes.
And what sort of a name is that? Chichikov.
It's a Slavic name, actually. It's rather old and...
I'd say what's Slavic and what's not Slavic in my house.
Right you are.
Sobakevich was a stout man, very tall, and was wearing a large dark brown fur coat with matching trousers. The legs and arms were too long for him, and together with his huge beard, the effect was to make him look exactly like a great bear.
What?
Nothing.
Maybe we should come back another time.
I am a patient man, but you sorely try me, sir. You sorely try me.
Oh.
State your business, sir.
As Chichikov went through his proposal, Sobakevich sat glaring at him, looking like he'd been issued with a human face that was still only at an experimental stage. His eyes did not flicker, his expression did not change. As Chichikov was speaking, he began to wonder if there were even a soul in that body, or if it was simply a mountain of flesh.
I am erecting a monument to the serfs of the Ukraine, and I'm gathering names for the plinth.
Plinth?
It seemed to Chichikov that the word plinth had deeply displeased Sobakevich. In fact, looking back, Chichikov felt that to Sobakevich, most words fell somewhere between bothersome and intolerably odious.
Yes. I'll sell you my dead serfs.
Oh, you will? Oh, very good. And how many serfs are we talking about?
Since the last census? 187 souls have been lost on this estate.
Mentally, Chichikov shouted. Out loud, he said.
Oh, that's most satisfactory. Perhaps we can fix a price.
Shall we say 100 rubles?
For 187 souls, well, that's a little bit more than I was anticipating.
For each soul, sir. 100 per soul.
Outwardly, Chichikov shouted.
You're having a laugh!
Inwardly, he said.
Oh, that's a trifle steep.
I'm having a what?
Sorry, I got them the wrong way around.
Thank you. I was thinking rather more of 80 kopecks per soul.
80 kopecks? For a man such as Mikheyev, the carriage maker? Not a carriage passed through his workshop that didn't come out sprung to perfection.
Oh.
And it would last, would it, mind you. He'd do the lacquering himself.
Oh.
80 kopecks.
Well, a ruble, then.
For a man like the cobbler Telyatnikov?
He's dead. They're all dead.
I know they're dead. You think I'd sell you such men when they were alive?
Well, I can't afford that. You know, unless we can agree a lower price, I'm afraid my business here is concluded.
50, then.
What?
40, you scoundrel.
Sorry, didn't you say 50?
30, you highwayman.
Is this each?
25, you cutthroat dog. 10, you chief among badgers.
Chief among what?
5, then, you phantom from a dark place.
150.
You have a boiled turnip for a heart, sir. At least give me 3.
What about 80 kopecks?
Done. You unholy cesspool.
I'll draw up the deed of purchase in the morning.
I'll write out the list of souls myself.
Thank you.
You mollusk of Satan.
Right, 187 new souls. That makes 451 altogether.
Yes.
Did you see the way I looked him in the eye?
Yes, I did.
Do you remember what I said?
Yes, I do.
I said, I'm afraid my business here is concluded.
Yes, I know.
So he knew he'd met his match, all right. You could see it in his eyes.
Oh, I am so bald.
As I stood my ground, I stared him in the eye. I said, 2 rubles and 50, you mollusk, you worm. I won't pay you another kopeck so long as I live. And I am prepared to fight to the death because I...
Chichikov was in high spirits for the whole of the 3-hour journey back to town. He would perhaps have been less ebullient if he'd known that shortly after his departure, Sobakevich received a second set of visitors that evening.
The Hound of Darkness! The Weasel of Beelzebub!
Calm yourself, incomparable, sir, I pray you.
He's robbed me, you say? Monster of depravity!
Now, I didn't say he'd robbed anyone. I just said we need to investigate.
The wretched pestilence! Mm.
Oblivious to the curses he'd inspired, Chichikov returned to town, 451 serfs the richer, and wasted no time letting people know.
Yes, I shall be transporting these serfs to my estate in a couple of days.
Oh, yes, sir. Where's that?
Kherson.
I can do it. Kherson. But please, I beg you, don't breathe a word about my 451 souls. Not to anyone.
Oh, mum's the word.
And just as day follows night, soon everyone in town knew about Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov, the Kherson landowner, and his hundreds and hundreds of souls. Excuse me, sir. Can I ask you what you've heard about Mr. Chichikov's serfs?
Oh, I say good luck to him.
Do you?
Yeah, if I had that sort of money, I'd probably do the same.
Excellent, thank you.
Buy a load of serfs, put your feet up, read a paper, very nice.
Well, thank you for your time.
A glass of beer, maybe a sandwich, bish bosh.
Goodbye.
Where's this going to be on?
Go away.
I mean, it's not right, is it? I mean, they come over here, they steal our women, they buy our souls. I mean, what next?
He's a good player, solid in defence, but he can go forward if you need him.
Oh.
Kisishev plays midfield for Charlton.
I think you're in the wrong story.
I think you are, mate.
No, he's got this look, you know. Who sends shivers down his spine? Helps, too, that he's not short of a bob or two. Are you all right?
Good dog, madam. He's
always just playing. Best let him do that. Otherwise, he gets a bit nasty.
Nice boy.
What? A million here?
No, it was another word.
What? Bigger than a millionaire?
Yevgeny had this word.
Oh, well, suddenly Yevgeny's an expert.
I'm telling you, a gazillionaire. That's it. Chichikov's a gazillionaire, he reckons.
Is a gazillion more than a million, then?
Listen to him. What would you rather have? A million rubles or a gazillion?
Wow, a gazillion?
Exactly.
News whipped through the town like fire in a summer forest, and everywhere livened the spirits of the townspeople. The thought that they had in their midst a Kherson landowner, a romantic and a gazillionaire to boot, made them feel that their town had been somehow blessed. Lovers felt a little closer that summer. Children played wilder games in the streets. Everyone walked a little taller, spoke a little louder, and held their opinions with greater confidence, because Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov was in their town.
Well, I ought to be returning to my estate.
But surely you won't miss the midsummer procession.
Or the harvest pomping.
The festival of the spoon.
No, I really can't.
But dear Mr. Chichikov, sir, you will, I hope, accept the governor's invitation to the ball on Friday. Ah. It is the height of the Ukrainian social calendar.
Even so, the estate won't farm itself.
Dancing and music.
No, tempting, but no.
And hundreds of the most beautiful women in Russia.
Did you say Friday?
Pavel Ivanovich.
Oh, still here, are you? Well, I suppose I could rearrange my diary.
He wasn't ignoring me deliberately. The whirlwind around him, he must have found it difficult. Sometimes I wouldn't get to talk to him for a whole evening. At least until the end of the night, when Selifan and I would carry him back to the inn.
I want all my serfs lined up in front of the inn for the... Line them up, come on, in front for inspection. I tolerate no disobedience. You tell him.
Shh, please.
You know who
keep
I am.
Keep the noise down, sir.
You
please.
Know, don't shush me. I will not be shushed. I am the Kherson landowner, Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov. So there.
He can be forgiven if the attention went to his head somewhat. After all, it's not often you get to be the guest of honour at Governor's Ball.
Evening, sir.
Good evening, Yakov.
Great honour to have you with us, Mr. Chichikov, sir.
Oh, well, thank you, Yakov.
Well, hello, Pavel Ivanovich.
Good evening, madam.
Do you dance? I should like to mark my card with your name, Mr. Chichikov.
You get in line, baby. Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov marks his card for no one.
Pavel Ivanovich, most honoured guest. Welcome, welcome. Because, you know, what you're thinking of.
Take the gentleman's coat and hat.
Yes, sir.
Gav, we're so pleased you could join us.
Only too happy to show my face for a bit.
Won't we not have the pleasure of your company long?
Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov has a great number of calls upon his time, I'm sure you'll understand.
Well, naturally, we are very fortunate to have you in our town at all, dear sir. And the party's in the ballroom, sir. Ah. You care to accompany me?
Yes, sure, lead on.
Yeah, it's just through these doors.
How do I look?
Exquisitely turned out as ever, sir.
Right, let's go in.
Oh, and some old friends are here to see you. Korobotska, Manilov, and Anton Bakevich.
What?
When the great doors opened to reveal him, a hush descended on the room. The orchestra at once forgot to play, and all eyes turned towards him.
Hello.
Please, Pavel Ivanovich, our honored guest, cannot stay all evening. But he tells me he will do his best to get round everyone in the room before he goes.
And Chichikov began to move through the room, spreading smiles of joy as he went. These smiles were infectious. It was impossible not to be swept up in these ever-widening circles of laughter and happiness. Even I was soon engulfed in the happiness pulsing from the lone figure passing through the crowd.
Would you be able to inspect the new factories, Mr. Chichikov?
Wish I could, Konstantin. Wish I could. Would you sign this for my wife? Come on, no autographs, please. You know my rule.
Will you be visiting our town again? Soon? Sometime? Ever? Please?
I make you no promises, but hey, I'll try.
How lovely to see you again, Mr. Cheeky Chops.
Oh.
I will not have you think that I joined willingly in this ambush, my both mathematically and dynamically sublime friend. We've got some questions for you, you fiend of the underworld.
Everything all right, Pavel Ivanovich?
Yes, fine. Should we go outside? Mm-hmm.
You're trying to give us the runaround.
I can assure you.
Trying to pull the wool over our eyes,
not,
were
not,
you?
No, not in the slightest.
You said you admired my politesse.
You felt for my plight.
You wanted a plinth.
Yes, I did say those things.
Well, what do you have to say for yourself?
Why do you want these, sir?
Well, because...
Yes?
Well, because my...
Your what?
My mother. Yes, my mother.
No lies, no, Chichikov.
She's ill, very ill. My mother's very ill.
And?
Well, she wanted me to get some serfs.
What?
Because she wanted me to be a success. Yeah, that's it. That's right. She always wanted me to be a success. You know, her little boy. And so I thought I would get some serfs on paper and make it look like I was successful and she would probably get better.
That is the most beautiful story I have ever heard.
I had placed you in the starry firmament. I had no notion just how high you twinkle.
Oh, Pavel Ivanovich, I feel very ashamed. I thought you acted selfishly. I'd even begun to think that there might be some enormous bank fraud.
Bank fraud? Oh, no, I trust you will keep my dear mother's secret to yourselves.
Oh, of course.
Of course.
After you, madam, gentlemen.
Pavel Ivanovich, we've missed you. Where have you been?
Thank goodness you've returned. We've been waiting to begin the dancing.
Old friends, that's all. Let the dancing begin.
Ladies and gentlemen, please take your places for the quadrille.
Mrs. Korobotchka.
Oh, I would be delighted.
Chichikov, where have you been? Worried sick.
Who is that man?
Oh, nobody. Just a hanger-on.
Leave now. To be trouble. Spotted nostril.
Leave me alone.
What's he saying?
I have absolutely no idea.
Sounded like he was saying nostril. Who's that?
Nostril.
Pavel! Pavel! Pavel!
For the second time that evening, conversations were abandoned and all eyes turned towards the door.
Oh my God, it's Nostriov.
Pavel, you rogue!
I don't know who you are, sir, but will you kindly stop talking to our honoured guest in that disrespectful manner? This is Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov.
Oh, yes, your honoured guest.
Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov, the cursed landowner. What have you told them, Pavel Ivanovich? What have you told them?
Whatever is the fellow babbling about? Now, someone remove him!
Told you about his lands, has he?
I do apologise, Pavel Ivanovich. We're quite aware of his extensive property. Thank you. We do not need your assistance.
Oh, yes. I stopped at the inn on my way here.
Yeah, we can all see that.
Yeah, they told me all about his lands and the hundreds of souls he's going to have working them. But did you tell them what's really special about those souls, Pavel? Did you tell them? You all know what he's been buying to farm his estate.
Governor, would you stop him, please? Shut him up.
Well, I'll tell you. Dead souls. That's what he's buying.
What on earth is he talking about, Pavel Ivanovich? Stop him, someone!
Chichikov! Chichikov!
Tell them, Pavel! Tell them all! Chichikov. Dead souls!
Chichikov!
Dead souls!
Dead Souls, the narrator was played by Michael Palin, Chichikov by Mark Heap, and Selifan by Graham Hawley. Manilov was played by David Fleischman, Sobakevich by Wiley Longmore, Korobotchka by Judith Davis, and Nozdryov by Toby Haydoke. Sound design was by Steve Brook. Dead Souls was written by Nikolai Gogol, dramatised by Dan Robolato, and directed in Manchester by Polly Thomas.
I don't know who you are, sir, but will you kindly stop talking to our honoured guest in that disrespectful manner? This is Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov.
Oh, yes, your honoured guest. You all know what he's been buying. You all know what he wants working his land.
Governor, stop him, shut him up.
Well, I'll tell you. Dead souls, that's what he's buying.
What on earth is he talking about, Pavel Ivanovich?
Dead souls. Dead souls!
No, you shouldn't...
Stop him!
Ow!
Oh, I do hope they won't hurt him.
No, certainly not. He is an honoured guest. We will simply keep him in a temporary holding facility until such a time as he can refute these absurd allegations in the proper manner.
In the east side of a nameless Russian town in the middle of the 19th century, Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov, businessman, traveller, entrepreneur, sat forlornly in prison.
Well, it's not strictly prison.
Well, it's as good as.
No, it's a police cell. You know, it's a temporary holding facility.
In the east side of a nameless Russian town in the middle of the 19th century, Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov sat forlornly in a temporary holding facility. Prior to his trial and almost certain execution.
What are you talking about?
Oh, I suppose you haven't heard.
Heard? Heard of what?
Everyone's meeting at the police chief's house. They're deciding what to do with you.
What do you mean, do with me?
Well, there's a sizable body of opinion that wants to see you hanged.
Oh, my God.
Oh, don't worry. They're in the minority.
Well, thank heaven for that.
The rest think that's barbarous.
Good for them.
They want you shot.
Shot?
Simple, effective.
I can't die. I'm too young. I've got plans. I have potential. I have so much to give.
This is you we're talking about?
Oh, you've got to help me.
I just tell stories. I don't get involved. I'm very strict about that.
No exceptions.
Let me have a look. Where is it here? Only in the case of authorial delinquents or fatal narrative droop.
What if I promise to be good?
What do you mean?
You get me out of here and I'll turn over a new leaf.
No more schemes? No more deception?
You'll see a new Chichikov.
I'll see what I can do.
Just get me out of here.
Can I come too?
No!
Indeed, over at the Chief of Police's house, the case of Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov was being deliberated on, weighed up, scrutinised and debated by the very finest minds that the town could muster.
From another
I mention...
Oh, are you blind? Look at his eyebrows. Those are the eyebrows of an anarchist.
If a man looks like a Belgian and talks like a Belgian, I say he is a Belgian. A Walloon spy for the Catholic persuasion.
Please, please, we can't all talk at once. Let us examine the facts. A, we are currently holding a man who goes by the unlikely name of Mr. Chichikov. B, this so-called Chichikov has been in our local area for the last month trying to buy dead souls. May the angels keep and preserve them. And C, he has not been able to give a satisfactory account for his reasons for making these purchases.
First he said he was helping us out. Yeah, then he's putting up a monument. Well, then it was for his sick mother.
Now, the questions that we need to answer are, who is this man, and what is his purpose with our beloved dead souls? May God have mercy on them.
He's a wizard!
A spy!
None of us is safe.
Oh, don't worry yourself, Eliana. He's safely under lock and key, and the key's right here with me. Look!
But who is this monster?
Goodness me, goodness me. But haven't you worked it out yet?
It was the postmaster who spoke with this quiet confidence.
The man you have in your cells can be none other than the celebrated Captain Kopeikin. The captain's story is a sad one, though shot through with heroism and human feeling. Now, let's just say it's only a matter of time before one of our great storytellers commits his tale to eternity.
Ha! Great storyteller! What do you know about great
story? The story begins at an ending. The end of the campaign of 1812. Oh, they were terrible days, my friends. Our Russian motherland wept for her brave fallen children. And in those glorious days, let's just say, none fought more bravely than Captain Kopeikin. Valiant he was. Indomitable. But at such a cost. In the final throes of battle, a sly Frenchman's sabre cost him his right arm and his left leg just below the... Would you stop that?
I'm only trying to help.
Now, in those days, we had yet to establish the Veterans Hardship Fund. So, Kopeikin, who was without family or other means of assistance, decided to make the long journey to St. Petersburg with the idea of petitioning the emperor for, well, let's just say, money. Oh, St. Petersburg.
Ding dong, ding dong, ding dong, ding dong.
Ding dong, ding dong, ding dong, ding dong. I said... Now, actually, that's rather good, thank you. The bronze horseman, the admiralty, the Nevsky Prospect, sights, let's just say, calculated by that city's founders to dazzle the eyes and delight the mind. Oh, but this city costs, mind you. Oh, yes. And to a man of Kopeikin's limited means, it was soon taking hungry bites of his savings and discovering that the emperor himself was not yet returned to the city, he resolved to pay a visit to the town military commission. He pulled on his ragged uniform, pinned on his badges, jammed a wooden crutch beneath his arm, and soon he was rapping at the door.
Knock, knock, knock.
Yeah, but, excuse me. Sorry, Ivan Andreich. Did you say Chichikov is this Captain Kopeikin?
Oh, indeed so.
But didn't you also say that Kopeikin had an arm and a leg missing? Chichikov has all his limbs intact.
I do feel a bit of a fool.
Oh, you.
What a plot.
I'm enjoying that.
Sorry, everyone. Red herring.
Oh. Well, I think we can rule out Kopeikin. Does anyone else have a theory?
Who can understand the human mind? The most rational of men can abandon a belief in God, yet still fear that he will die if the fifth man to walk into a tavern has a beard. And the same jumble of idiocy and stupidity took hold of the assembled dignitaries. Any thought, no matter how idiotic, would take root in their brains. They were, let's say, what we politely call a bunch of morons. A stupider, more thick skull. I'll get my coat.
Well, really?
Anyone else with a suggestion? No? Well, permit me to draw your attention to a very real possibility that we must consider. You have seen the facts. I'm afraid, to my mind, they point in only one direction. I'm sorry to say that your Mr. Chichikov is in fact none other than... Napoleon Bonaparte!
Oh, I thought he was dead.
Governor, you can never trust a Frenchman.
Well, that's true, of course.
Yes, Boney himself.
faked his own death and has come to Russia to gather an army of the living dead, heaven keep them from harm, that will avenge the losses of 1812.
God bless them all.
Fortunately for our beautiful land, we have captured the necromancer. I will redouble the guard in the morning and then...
Sir!
What is it, Sergeant?
It's the prisoner, sir. He's escaped.
Of course. Impossible. I have the keys here. That rude chap. He's stolen them.
What?
Ladies and gentlemen, this is a grave situation. Napoleon Bonaparte, erstwhile Emperor of the French turned military recruiter to the underworld, is at large. We must pursue him. To horse! After him!
After him!
Stopping only to summon Selifan, the coachman, from his evening of quiet contemplation, and have him bring the coach to the prison.
Temporary holding facility.
I unlocked the doors, and with one bound, Chichikov was free.
Free! I'm free! Free! Free at last!
No, not you.
Quickly now. It won't be long before they discover the keys are missing.
The coach!
Evening, sir.
You thought of everything.
I did my best.
Who are all those people, sir?
It's them. They're onto us.
Sullivan, drive! Drive like the wind!
Yeah! Ah!
No, no! When we're inside it.
Oh, sorry, sir.
Very much, you idiot.
Now!
Napoleon Bonaparte, you haven't heard the last of this!
Yeah.
Give chase! After them!
Onward! Onward!
Are they still behind us?
No, I think we've lost them.
What did he shout after?
I've no idea.
Oh, phew. That was a close one, wasn't it?
Wasn't it? You were nearly for the... Whack!
Yeah. I was what?
You know, nearly for the...
Yeah! I don't know what you're talking about.
Nearly for the ready, aim, fire.
All right, that.
But a very satisfactory result in any case.
Well, indeed, yes.
Even if I do say so myself.
What do you mean?
Well, rescuing you.
Technically, perhaps, but I was the brains behind the operation.
What nonsense. You just sat in prison.
Sat in prison? Excuse me, I had the whole thing planned out.
I don't know why I bother.
Well, I didn't know you did.
Oh, poo you.
Poo you.
There will be some who doubt the wisdom of placing a figure like Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov at the centre of any kind of story. The ladies in particular are impatient with the slightest imperfections of character, and no matter how deeply the storyteller penetrates into the mysteries of the human mind, there will be those who prefer their heroes always to be heroes. But I say to the ladies, we live in new times. The age of the hero is past. Now is the time for the non-virtuous man. The squalid, the pitiful, the pathetic.
Oi.
But anyway, let's leave our non-virtuous hero while I tell you what happened the next day. 150 miles from the last town, enclosed in a valley and shielded by trees, lay the estate of Andrei Ivanovich Tentetnikov.
Nice place you've got here.
Good, if you like greenery. Your master... Not a travelling salesman, is he?
No, nothing like that.
Who is he, then?
He is an extremely famous Russian novelist who desires to go incognito for a while, what with all the people who love his books wanting a piece of him.
All right. Good morning, sir.
He's here, sir.
Good morning to you, dear sir. I crave your forgiveness for descending upon you like this. I imagine on such an estate so far from the common traffic ways you rarely encounter visitors.
It's true. We're very isolated here. No one ever visits.
Excellent. Allow me to introduce myself. I am an extremely famous Russian novelist who desires to go incognito for a while, what with all the people who love my books wanting a piece of me.
Is that right? Extremely famous?
In, of course, my own highly specialised genre of quality fiction.
Well, maybe I've heard of you. What's your name?
It's Chichikov.
Chichikov?
Yes.
That's a very unusual name.
Well, it is by way of a nom de plume.
See. What can I do for you?
My carriage appears to have sustained a minor impairment owing to my driver's carefree way with potholes.
Sorry, Mr. Chicken Cough.
I understand how much you must value your solitude, but I wondered if we might stay here a while to arrange the repair of my vehicle.
Yeah, I suppose so. It makes no difference to me. Little human company would be welcome, I suppose.
Your kindness is beyond compare, my dear sir. We will be gone from here in a matter of hours.
Mysteriously, the repair to the wheel served mainly to reveal problems with the axle. Repairing the axle only brought more clearly to attention certain deficiencies in the brakes. Soon Chichikov's... Chichikov's matter of hours had become a matter of days, and it wasn't long before the matter of days had become a matter of weeks.
Well, you needn't say it like that. Mr. Tentetnikov doesn't mind. You don't mind, do you?
No, I don't mind.
There, you see, he doesn't mind my being here.
Here, not here. Makes no difference.
I took a walk down by the stream this morning. Sensational.
So they say.
What about your library, eh? First class, absolutely first class. Books, eh? What would we do without them?
They save on wallpaper. You know, I heard the strangest rumour in the village.
What's that?
The gardener's lad said that Napoleon Bonaparte has returned to Russia and is trying to raise an army.
Bonaparte? But he's dead, isn't he?
Well, that's what I thought.
But how odd. Pay it no heed.
I suppose so.
Are you sketching?
Oh, just doodling. There's nothing else to do.
Well, do let me see, my dear friend.
No, really, it's nothing.
Oh, it's really very good, really. Who is she? Oh, my dear sir, compose yourself.
Why?
Is she dead?
She might as well be. I can't see her.
Why, please, dear, my dear friend, tell me what happened.
I have broken with her father.
Ah, the father.
And for him to talk to me like that.
What did he say?
He called me.
What?
He dared to call me.
Yes.
My dear chap.
He did what, sorry?
I know. Unbelievable, isn't it?
So you broke off the engagement because he called you my dear chap.
Well, what else could I have done?
Inwardly, Chichikov thought,
you are a complete and utter total deep-fried nutcase.
But instead, he said,
that's quite right. What a nerve.
Well, go on.
What?
Offer to help.
What, help him?
Mm-mm. New leaf, remember?
Yeah, but...
You promised.
Oh, all right.
Thank you.
My dear friend, you were insulted. You made your feelings very plain. But perhaps now is the time to make amends, to allow the hurt to fade into distant memory, to gather those heartstrings that once were broken and mend them with love.
What?
Well, I don't know.
I'm sorry. I know I should... But I have my pride. I will not grovel to that man. Whatever it costs me.
No, indeed. But perhaps you'd permit me to call on this gentleman and pay him our respective respects.
You? But why would you?
You ask me why? Why?
Consider it the smallest repayment.
Consider it the smallest repayment for the kindness you have shown in welcoming me into your house as your guest.
What a strange man,
thought Andrei Ivanovich Tentetnikov.
What an idiot,
thought Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov.
I shall leave first thing. Who will I have the honour of meeting?
His name is General Betrishev.
And indeed, bright and early, Chichikov awoke, dressed himself with vaguely military crispness, and seated himself in Mr. Tentetnikov's carriage, the master having gratefully offered him use of it for the day. Andrei Ivanovich himself paced the library in a more than usual state of tension and excitement. Not daring to believe that Chichikov's plan could succeed, it was with a tear in his eye that he watched the carriage leave the courtyard, And, unseen by anyone, he waved them off with one of his monogrammed cambric handkerchiefs. Hey, wait for me! Hey, wait!
Never heard of you.
Well, I have a small but loyal following.
Don't have much time for books myself.
No?
No.
I see.
If the General were a colour, he would be purple. In fact, the General was a colour, and that colour was purple.
What did he say?
Books, eh? It's interesting, because on the estate where I'm currently lodging, there's a really magnificent library.
Any books on war?
Books on...
War books. Mm. Books on war. Has he got any? Huh? No, I don't think so.
Well, actually...
Yeah?
Mr. Chichikov's friend is writing one.
What?
It's brilliant. Yes, he's writing a book right now. It's a book. It's a book about war. It's one of those war books.
War. Mm.
In fact, he's writing it about generals.
That's right, generals.
Generals?
Yes. It's a war book about generals.
Yeah. Which generals?
Oh, just...
Generals?
You know, generals in general. Yeah.
What era?
The era. Good question. What era did he say?
The era was...
Was it the... Hmm? Oh, it's on the tip of my tongue.
Yeah, well, the Napoleonic campaign, for example.
That's the fella, yes.
Bingo.
Yes. How could I forget that?
Definitely Napoleonic.
Well, yes. You may be interested to learn that I gained these medals in that campaign.
Did you now?
I thought I recognised them.
Is your friend looking at any particular battle?
Oh, now is he? Is he?
I'm sure he must.
Yes.
Mustn't he?
Well, he did tell me.
Terrible memory for names.
Yeah, Borodino, perhaps? What?
So did you fight at Borodino?
Aye. Did.
What? That's an extraordinary, isn't
mad
it?
Coincidence. Because that's a very, didn't he say...
Yes, well, that is in fact the main section of the book.
Oh.
Borodino. I mean, day and night, give me a break. I'm sick of hearing it.
But not really, because we do love war and killing.
Oh. War and killing. Brilliant.
Well, if this friend of yours is hoping to write a truly authoritative history, he should really come and talk to me. I should be pleased to give him my account.
Well, we'll certainly pass that on to Ten Technikov, won't we?
Soon as we get back.
Did you say Ten Technikov?
Why, yes. Do you know him?
Well, I did. He and my daughter had an understanding at one time, and then took offence at something or other. Damned if I know what it was.
Well, how interesting. I had no idea.
Oh, he struck me as a very high-strung sort of fella.
Really? Well, maybe once. I couldn't say, but certainly now he's a lion of a man.
Ah. Andrei Ivanovich is writing a book on Borodino, is he?
Yeah.
Well,
indeed.
A notable change came over the general. His severity softened, an almost avuncular quality entered into his manner. Even his colouring joined in the celebrations, mellowing from a deep purple to an almost carefree scarlet.
Ten Technico. Hmm? Well.
He even began to laugh.
Ha, ha, ha.
And Chichikov also laughed, but in deference to the general's war record, he chose a less prominent vowel with which to do so. So great was the change in the general's spirits that a full reconciliation with Tentechnikov was effected the very next day. And the following evening, all five of us were sitting around the general's table as if we were the very oldest of friends.
I think this calls for another bottle.
Oh, allow me, your high excellency. You're a miracle worker, Chichikov.
Was nothing.
I owe you my life, my happiness. Is there anything I can do for you?
Well, actually, you did mention a few days ago those souls of yours who died last winter.
Hold on, I'd better get this bottle. I'll be right back.
You're not still after those dead souls.
A plan is a plan.
Chichikov.
General!
Today I've seen the light return to my daughter's eyes. I thank you. Now, without your astonishing news, I would not have seen it.
What news, Papa?
Well, your father is a fool. My dearest one, a silly, fat-headed fool. I misjudged that young man. He's got a good, sensible head on him.
I cannot tell you what good it does my heart to see the two of you so happy together.
These last few months have been agony.
Oh, my dear, no need to go over all that again.
Some evenings I've done nothing but cry in my room.
No more tears.
I hope you'll be very happy together.
And indeed, a change had come over Chichikov, too. That evening, seeing the lovers reunited, he'd begun to imagine himself sitting at a grand dinner table beside a Mrs. Chichikov, with perhaps from the nursery the distant sound of a brace of little Chichikovs. He imagined being the head of a family, presiding over a family home, a grand residence that stood perhaps on an estate of his own.
This is the Chichikov estate,
he mused.
You are now entering Chichikovia,
he pondered.
Welcome, one and all, to Chichland.
It suddenly seemed to Chichikov that he must have these things, if only to show the world and himself that he had lived and existed, that his span of years had left an imprint, that he had not merely passed over the earth like a shadow.
Tell me what you want.
Pardon me?
My daughter's happiness is beyond price, but you must take something. I insist upon it.
Well...
anything.
Well, I hear there was a bad outbreak of typhoid fever last winter.
Oh. Here we are.
Reinforcements.
You know, I was just talking to the girls in the kitchen.
Oh, well.
Quite innocently, I assure you. But they told me the strangest thing.
Now, what's that?
Well, there have been some strangers in the village asking questions.
Now, what's so strange about that?
Well, they say they're looking for a man who buys dead souls.
Dead souls?
That's what they said.
But how horrible.
Oh, darling, please, don't upset yourself.
What a horrible thing.
Don't worry, I told them. If he's coming anywhere around here, he won't come to us. He'll go to my aunt Alexandra Ivanovna in Kiev. She must have thousands of dead souls buried on her estate.
You mustn't joke about it.
Don't you worry yourself, my dear. I can assure you that if anyone comes to our door trying to buy dead souls or dead horses or dead anything... Well, upstairs in my room I have a trunk. And in that trunk I have a rifle snatched from the dying hands of a perfidious Frenchman. And as God is my witness, I follow the principle we followed in 1812. Shoot first, think second.
You're not eating your soup, Chichikov?
No.
In fact, we should probably be...
be on our way.
Moving on.
Moving on?
Yeah, the carriage is mended, so...
Hit the road.
Well, what can I say? Thank you.
Not at all.
From both of us.
It was my pleasure.
Watch out for Bonaparte.
Yes, will do.
Shoot first, think second, like we did at Borodino.
Borowato?
Well, no, I really do have to go.
Toodaloo.
You said a funny word.
There's nothing funny about Borodino, sir.
You said it again. Borodingo.
Take that back, sir.
Father, put the stick down.
Butterbongo.
That went well.
Yeah, but they're on to us.
We'll be fine. We just got to keep one step ahead.
Yeah, as long as we don't stay in one place too long.
And no more dead souls.
Oh, really?
Yes, really.
Well, what, not even one or two?
You've had enough.
What about the little ones?
No dead souls for you.
Ooh, right.
Good.
You're probably right.
You know I am.
It's only money.
That's the spirit.
There's more to life than money.
Exactly.
There's power, fame, fancy clothes.
Love, goodness, honour.
Ooh, yeah, and all those things too. Would you ever own land?
I never really thought about it.
Yeah, nor me. I was just thinking.
I don't know what I'd do with it.
Farm it.
Obviously.
Yeah, obviously. I'd grow potatoes.
Well, it goes without saying. Wheat. You'd probably want fields of wheat.
What about you, Selifan?
Oh, don't ask me, sir. I wouldn't have first idea.
Yeah, well, maybe not, but you can join in.
I've never had cause to think.
Well, still, come on, humorous.
Well, if I had a small acreage, I don't know, well, I think I'd probably end up, who knows, investing in small-scale agricultural machinery, working a four-field rotational system on the Dutch model, experimenting for the first 3 years to find the optimal ratio between the economies of scale made possible through Euro-industrial farming techniques and a prudent diversification to avoid the threat of monoculture and all its attendant risks of sharp market fluctuation and financial exposure to environmental change.
Selifan?
Yes, sir.
Who's driving this coach?
Oh, Booker!
By the way, I don't suppose by any chance you happen to catch the name of Mr. Tetnikov's aunt?
Alexandra Ivanovna, why?
No reason. Well, good night.
Good night.
Hey,
Is this the Tentetnikov estate?
It is.
Pardon my intrusion, but I and my associates are on the trail of a dangerous criminal. Have you had any visitors in the last fortnight? Visitors perhaps inquiring about dead serfs?
We have had someone, in fact.
Oh, you have? Excellent. Okay, boys, let's not get ahead of ourselves. Now, the man we're looking for is about so high, brown hair, ratty little face.
That certainly sounds like him.
Oh, about, he wears dandified coats and tight trousers that don't suit him.
Our guest fitted that description.
Thinning hair, stooping gait, a curious smell emanating
from
him.
That's him.
And he goes by the name of Chichikov.
Well, our guest called himself Chichikov.
Chichikov, eh?
Yes, sir.
Blast. It's not him, boys. No, we'll try the next village. Thank you very much, sir. Come on, don't worry about it.
The next day, we found ourselves in a small village surrounded by large estates, a little to the north of the Dnieper River. And we began making some inquiries about the landowners in the district.
Kostin Zoglo.
No. Sorry. Do you know who owns this estate?
Kostin Zoglo.
Oh, no. Look, the big man, very important, in the big house. In the big house?
Aye. Kostin Zoglo.
Oh, that's no use. I can't understand his accent.
I don't have an accent.
Oh, all right, so you speak Russian?
Of course I speak Russian. What do you think I am, a peasant? Well, technically, yeah, I am, but still. No need to be patronising.
All right, well, I've asked you 3 times about the landowner.
And I've told you 3 times. It's Mr. Kostin Zoglo.
All right, I see. And what about the next estate?
That'll be Mr. Koshkaryov.
Kostin Zoglo and Koshkaryov. Thank you.
Chichikov gazed at the peasant before him and, not for the first time, observed the difference between the fine bone structure of men like himself, born to own and farm large estates, and the coarse, ugly physiognomy of the brute peasant whose skulls were, if anything, more animal than human.
Oh, is that right?
Oh. You really have got to stop doing that.
Sorry. Oh. Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov had got it into his head that he wanted to become a landowner and he should visit Kostin Zoglo and Koshkaryov's estates to get a sense of the latest farming techniques. I told him he couldn't afford it, but would he listen? Oh, no, Mr. Chichikov always knows best. And anyway, I told him what for, and he said some actually very hurtful things back to me, and I suppose I said some things back to him, and one thing led to... Well, anyway, he left in a huff. In fact, he didn't return until nightfall. And what sort of time do you call this?
Oh, I thought you were asleep.
Asleep? As if I could. I've been sick with worry.
Don't need to worry about me.
Does he leave a note? No, he just goes off without a by your leave.
I just went out.
Oh, just out. For 8 hours!
Can we talk about this in the morning?
You went to see that woman, didn't you? Tentetnikov's rich aunt.
I've got nothing to say.
I knew it.
Good night.
The next morning, we paid a visit to see Konstantin Fyodorovich Kostin Zoglo, a man whose affection for the land was matched only by his fondness for money.
You love soil, Mr...
Mr... Chichikov.
You love soil, Mr. Chichikov.
Love soil? No.
You cannot farm if you don't love soil.
I like soil. You know, some soil I like very much, but... love, I'm not...
Some of these chaps, young farmers, they spend their lives on what? Going to ale houses, after the theatre, with friends.
And that's a bad thing.
Are you mad? Are you a bad brain? Now, let me tell you something, my young friend. I would happily exchange the chance ever to step into another alehouse just to have warm, moist soil run between my fingers.
Really?
Oh, I'd gladly never, and that's never, visit a theatre again. If only I were guaranteed the chance to gaze at a freshly ploughed field once a month for 5 years.
Surely that is committed.
You have to love the land. You have to love it. See, I'd gladly cut off ties with all my friends to spend just one day in a year, just one day, buried up to my waist in good Russian soil. Crumbly, moist, melt in your mouth.
Melt in your what?
I've been a farmer here, man and boy, Mr. Chichikov, man and boy.
Oh, lucky you.
On my 12th birthday, my father gave me the lower field down by the stream. And do you know what I did?
Grew apples.
Apples? Mm. Apples? Are you mental? Are you a damaged man? I split the field, you see. Half of it flax, half of it turnips. That was September, and a year later, I made 4,000 for the flax, 5,000 for the turnips. Thank you very much.
9,000 in a year?
And I planted all the seed myself. I run the most efficient estate in the Ukraine. You know, there are some folk who believe that farming is the way to get rich quick.
Oh, really?
But they're wrong.
Oh, really?
Listen to me, my young friend. If you want to get rich quick, you'll never get rich at all. Now, if you're prepared to wait, to respect the seasons, plant the seed, wait until it is ready to harvest, let the earth tell you when it is ready, then, I promise you, rivers and rivers of gold will flow into your hands.
Of all the many agricultural lessons Kostanzhoglo taught him, this simple farming advice would ring through Chichikov's head for the rest of the day.
Rivers and rivers of gold will flow into your hands.
He found himself strangely attracted to the nobility of nature and the rigours of the farming.
Rivers and rivers of gold!
I am a landowner,
thought Chichikov.
I will farm like Kostanzhoglo.
And Chichikov continued to turn these words over in his mind as Kostanzhoglo proudly showed him over every single inch of the estate.
Well, I must say it's breathtaking, Mr. Kostanzhoglo. The views alone.
Oh, views, is it? Now, let me tell you something, my panoramic young friend. No view ever brought home 2 kopecks to put in the pot. So let's hear no more of views.
Quite right, views, pa.
Then I would gladly poke out both of my eyes if I knew I could still enjoy the smell of freshly ploughed earth.
Me too.
You're looking for an acreage in the area, eh?
Well, I'm very new to this game, sir. I shall need to educate myself more fully in the art and cultivation.
Oh, education now! Well, let me tell you something, my pedagogical young friend. No educated person ever had 2 kopecks to jingle in his pocket. You've no need of education. There's an estate not far from here, owned by one Klobuyev. You know him?
No, I don't.
Well, he's let it go to rack and ruin. It's a crime. He has more debts than bad ideas. Now, he would gladly sell them for a good price, too. Go see him this afternoon.
Well, I've arranged to see Mr. Koshkaryov this afternoon.
Ah, what are you wasting your time with that fool for?
Well, in the town, they said he had some innovative ideas.
Oh, so it's ideas now, isn't it? Well, let me tell you something, my philosophical young friend. No idea ever walked into a smart Moscow shop and bought a lady's fur hat with a quilted lining as a surprise for the fancy woman he keeps at his own expense in a small flat on the north side of the city. So let's hear no more of ideas.
In fact, despite Kostanzhoglo's warning, Chichikov was determined to keep his mind open in the matter of Colonel Koshkaryov. Loving the land is all very well, but he did not have 40 years to develop much of an affinity with topsoil. Hearing that Koshkaryov's estate was run on much more abstract, rational principles, he found himself warming to the idea of rational farming rather than mystical oneness with nature.
Good afternoon. Are you my 4 o'clock? You do have an appointment.
Yes.
This is Mr. Kikichov, the man who wants advice on farming.
Yes.
Then you have come to the right place. This is not just a farm. It is a glimpse of the future, Mr. Kikichov.
Oh, that sounds interesting.
Indeed it is. Organized entirely on rational principles, this farm is the most efficient estate in the whole of the Ukraine.
Oh, really? Only that Konstantin Fyodorovich Kostanzhoglo claimed his farm was the most efficient.
Poppycock. Pure poppycock.
So, with your methods, a farm always succeeds? It always makes money?
And how could it fail? Our principle is organization, reason.
Excellent.
Here at Koshkaryov Farming, we aim to produce happy, rounded peasants with a broad range of skills. Do you know, when I first came to this estate, not a single serf could play the piano.
You don't say?
Now they all can. Now, if I could only get them into German trousers...
German trousers.
The German trouser has a proven impact of 58% on productivity, 63% when it is a woolen trouser.
Right, cool.
Walk with me. The Research and Development Committee reported that fields are not themselves rational entities and therefore had no place on a modern farm.
Fields?
Yes. I don't know if you've ever seen one, but they're very messy, I hear.
What you hear?
It's a perfect example of how we work. The Research and Development Committee reports, the Building and Works Committee acted. We built a suite of offices over the fallow fields and converted the lake into a recreational area.
So you have no fields at all?
None. It's a wholly rational enterprise. Now, along this corridor, we have the Health and Safety Executive, the Quality Assurance Agency, and the Department...
Koshkaryov's farm was notable for the extraordinary number of departments whose work nobody understood, and whose reason for existing nobody could remember.
Well, it has been a pleasure meeting you. In fact, I insist that you come to dinner.
That's very kind of you.
Submit your application to the Department of Food and Leisure. Goodbye.
The colonel also recommended that he buy Klebuyev's land, despite its infestation with fields, but Chichikov couldn't pay even the minuscule asking price. Instead, he kept a low profile, didn't ask about dead souls, and generally behaved himself. Then, 3 weeks later, Chichikov received a message requesting his attendance in Kiev, where some good news awaited him.
Oh, it's a message.
Yes, I just said that.
Oh, we have to go to Kiev.
Yes, I said that bit too.
Well, did you mention that it would be...
Good news, yes.
Spoil sport.
This was surprising enough, but even more surprising was once we arrived at the appointed place to find...
Tentekov.
I was going to say that.
You were too slow, weren't you?
It's not a competition.
Says you.
It seemed that Tentetnikov's lapse over Borodino had been forgiven. Once it had been explained to the general that the young man found the subject of that great battle so stirring that if he did not make light of the matter, he could be thrown into a deep melancholy, which appeared to be the mood in which we found the young man.
Pavel Ivanovich.
Andrei Ivanovich. I was very sorry to hear.
Yes, yes.
What? What?
She was very old, of course. One mustn't be surprised.
Who was?
I only met her once, but her grace and goodness made an enormous impression on me.
Who? Who?
If you could all be seated, thank you.
What's going on?
Shh!
I have here the will of Mrs. Alexandra Ivanova Kanasarova.
Who's that?
The will is recent, signed and sealed less than a month ago, and its contents are as follows. To my son, Nikolai, I leave my house and its immediate grounds. May it be the home to you that ever it was to me.
Is this the rich aunt?
Might be.
To my cousins, Anna and Ivan Vasiliev, I leave my orchards. May the fruit in those orchards ripen for as long as ye both shall live. To my dear nephew, Andrei Ivanovich, I leave my coin collection. May it bring you great pleasure and much fun. And to my new friend, Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov...
What?
I leave 40,000 rubles.
Oh.
May the goodness of his soul and the nobility of his character continue to delight and inspire the countryside as it did me in my last month of life. This concludes the reading of the will.
What? Wait, what are you looking at me like that for?
Was that where you went that time?
I might have paid her a visit, yeah.
And she gave you all her money?
What can I say? She took a liking to me. I'm a very likeable person.
Are you?
Yes.
To whom?
Well, lots of people.
Name one.
Look, you ask me to turn over a new leaf, I turn over a new leaf. I just go to see a poor old woman.
A rich old woman?
Right, a rich old, poor old woman. And I tell her my story. I explain that I've been, I admit it, a very wicked man. I confess my dead soul's plan, but explain that, with the help of a good friend... I have found my blundering way back to the path of goodness. Do you want to use my handkerchief?
Thank you.
You okay?
Yes. Yes, I'm fine.
Tell you what, the weird thing about this whole situation is that, I'm now in a position to make an offer for Klebuyev's estate. It's funny, isn't it, the way things work out?
Yeah, I'll leave it for a bit, though. There's no need to rush.
And an unhurried 25 minutes later, we were standing discussing the sale in the drawing room of Mr. Klobuev, who was as keen to drive up the price of the estate as the estate itself seemed keen to drive it down.
Now, this is a lovely room.
Is it?
I had it redecorated last year.
Did you?
You'll notice the very unusual appearance of the walls.
Yes.
It's dry rot, isn't it?
Is it?
I think so.
They told me it was a design.
Yeah. Oh, well, still, nice windows.
Sorry.
So, anyway, what about the estate itself?
Yeah, the lower field is undergoing a process of natural irrigation.
So, meaning?
Flooded.
Or the upper field, then?
Yeah, we had a small fire there at last. It does not look at its best just at present.
How about the middle field?
It's a curious thing, but it appears to have blown away.
Hmm. How much are you asking?
The estate has been in my family for over 3 centuries. I do not exaggerate when I say that my family gave their lives to those fields. The honour of the Klobuyev says that I will not take anything less than 35,000 roubles.
20,000?
Anything. I'll take anything.
15,000,
then. It's a deal.
Yes, 14,900, 14,950, 15,000 roubles. There you are.
I'm most grateful.
Not at all.
Thank you so much.
It's a pleasure.
An honour to do business with you, sir.
Likewise.
Are you going to let go of the money?
Yeah, of course.
We must celebrate.
As you wish.
Some champagne? Koshka?
Oh, very nice.
Yes, sir.
Run to town and fetch us a bottle of champagne.
Yes, sir. On the account?
The estate account, yes.
That would be my account, would it?
This is your estate now, Pavel Ivanovich.
Yes.
You are a landowner. You have responsibilities.
I suppose that's true.
You better get 2 bottles, Koshka. Oh, and Koshka.
Yes, sir.
I've sold the estate, so you're fired.
Very good, sir.
Yes, sir.
Any messages?
Just 2, sir.
Well?
The work's outing to go paint catapulting in the Siberian forest. Should I add your name to the list?
Leave the dates with me. I'll see what I can do. And the other?
There's a man downstairs wants to know if you've seen Napoleon Bonaparte in the area.
I see. Well, give me his details and I'll call his people. That'll be all.
Very good, sir.
Did you say Napoleon Bonaparte?
Chichikov soon moved into the big house. He appointed me as his secretary and Selifan, the loyal coachman, as his factotum.
What?
Factotum?
What's a factotum? I don't know. Because I wouldn't want to do anything that my mother...
Butler. Yeah, you can be my butler. You can buttle for me.
And soon Chichikov laid plans for a celebratory dinner to introduce himself to the local people.
Just the important ones.
And as coaches, carriages and briskers began arriving at the door, Chichikov made the last-minute arrangements.
Sorry, would you close that window? There's a terrible draught.
That window doesn't close, sir. The frame's warped. I'll call the carpenter tomorrow. He can do the floorboard by the door, too.
So, what do you think, Selifan?
Well, it's big, it's old, it's a nice house, Mr. Chichikov, sir.
Well, yes it is. And it's mine, Selifan. Mine. My estate. Not that I'll let it change me. Oh, no. I'm still the same old Chichikov. Don't you worry about that.
Well, that's good to hear, sir.
Do you think this silk suit's a bit much?
No. Goes well with the diamond-encrusted crown.
Good. All right. Well, shoo them in.
Well, I think I owe you an apology. I doubted you, and I was wrong. You have turned over a new leaf.
Well, couldn't have done it without you.
Oh, no. It was all you.
You had a lot to do with it.
Well, let's just say 50-50.
70-30.
In whose favour?
Oh, and here they come.
The cream of Ukrainian society had turned out for Chichikov's estate warming. Tentetnikov stood with Yulinka, watched over by General Betrishev, his face a gentle crimson. Kostanzoglo debated soil management with Koshkaryov. Everyone admired Chichikov's quietly stylish decorations, the light and air of humble simplicity about the room.
Good light,
good air.
It's quiet.
But stylish.
You see?
Governor, ministers, councillors, ladies and gentlemen, you are all très bienvenus. The raison d'être for this little soirée...
The reason for this evening occasion...
...is to say... Bonjour.
Bonjour.
Hello.
To mes amis.
My friends.
A magnifique.
Super.
I humbly welcome you to my pied-à-terre.
Something about Earth?
Chez Chichikov.
Chichikov's house.
And now, je vous en prie.
Please.
Take a few moments to enjoy some hors d'oeuvre.
Party snack.
Canapé, vol-au-vent, amuse-bouche.
Crisps, pretzels,
and
twiglets.
A vin ordinaire.
Cheap wine.
But that's enough of me.
Hello, ça suffit.
What?
Sorry, I got the wrong way round again.
Enough of me. We have another cause for celebration this evening. Please raise your glasses to the happy couple, Mr. and Mrs. Ten Tetnikov. Andre and Yulinka.
Andre and Yulinka.
But enough speeches. I hear the signal that dinner is served. Selifan, would you open the doors to the dining room, please? Can I help you, officer?
Is your name Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov?
Yes?
Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov! I am hereby arresting you on the charge that on the 16th of July of this year you did deliberately procure or make a forgery of the will of Alexandra Ivanovna Kanasarova for reasons of personal gain.
My aunt!
No, this is nonsense.
Do you know who this is, officer?
Indeed I do, sir.
No, this is obviously some mistake.
Mr. Chichikov is a highly respected and distinguished member of the local landowning classes.
Yeah.
I hope you have some evidence to back up these outrageous allegations.
We do indeed.
Says you.
We have some very strong evidence, actually.
Oh, well, evidence. Hey?
We found the original will.
No, you haven't.
Oh, haven't we?
No.
And what makes you say that?
Because I burnt it, so there. Whoops.
You burned my aunt's will?
Sorry, did I say burned? No, I meant,
Yes.
I meant,
Well?
Spurned. Yeah, I meant spurned.
Spurned? You spurned my aunt's first will?
I'm just going to go over there.
Stop him!
I told you that floorboard was dodgy.
Good evening, Mr. Cheeky Chops.
Oh, no.
Yes, this is the man, officer.
Pavel Ivanovich Chichikov, you are also charged on a second count of fraudulently acquiring deeds of ownership relating to 451 serfs.
They weren't any use to anybody.
Nonetheless, Pavel Ivanovich...
I wasn't doing anything illegal.
But
it's
you
just
did...
a few dead souls, that's all. Just some dead souls.
Please come with me, sir.
Help me.
How could you?
Oh, well, you know.
Turned over a new leaf, you said?
Well, I sort of did.
I feel totally betrayed.
Look, it's all been a terrible misunderstanding.
He blustered.
Hey, he's a liar. Arrest this man.
He charged.
Don't let them take me.
He pleaded.
I've got so much to give. Probably.
The crowd stared accusingly.
You have to do something.
Not this time.
I promise. I've learned my lesson. Look, this is the new Chichikov.
I've heard it all before.
Just get me out of this and you'll see.
If you let me down.
I promise.
Right. Follow me. As he turned to face the crowd, they seemed to see a new Chichikov stood before them, his back straighter than before, a new nobility in his eye, and with a voice trembling with feeling, he started to speak.
So, is that me?
Yes, you're on.
Right. Guests. Friends. I have been a scoundrel. The lowest of men.
Voice trembling with feeling.
Forgive me. I have hurt no one. I hoped only to achieve a social position. What is this world when a good man is forced to the bad to gain the respect of his fellows?
Good. Now take it up a level.
Friends, I am at your mercy. My life has been like a ship tossed on a stormy sea. I wished no one harm. I sought only to secure for myself the still waters of the simple life. Friends, can you find it in your hearts to forgive me?
Around the room, there was not a woman without a tear slipping down her cheek. Not a man who had not felt something softening in his heart. In all of their minds, a single word was forming. Forgiveness. Chichikov's eloquence, his sincerity, his evident depth of feeling and genuine humility before
them. Excuse me?
What is it?
Are you talking about us?
Yes, if I could continue.
Well, it's just that I don't think we are all thinking about forgiveness, are we?
No, certainly not.
Look, who's telling the story? His genuine humility before the Court of Human Judgment weighed heavily with the assembled group.
No, I didn't.
The assembled group were struck silent with compassion.
No, we weren't.
The group decided to shut up talking.
We've got the exits covered, officer. Arrest this man!
Now what do we do?
Plan B.
Plan B?
Cellophane, the window. Run!
Chichikov, wait for me!
Everyone, give chase!
Hey?
After them!
Cellophane, what are you waiting for? Come on, let's go!
Chichikov? Chichikov!
Hurry up, Cellophane!
Chichikov, let me in. They're almost here.
Onward! Onward!
Chichikov, open the door! Chichikov, what are you doing? Pull the blind up and let me in. They're almost here.
So, sir, hold on. Yeah! Where to, sir?
Onward!
But where to?
Oh, it doesn't matter. Onward! Onward!
Yeah!
Chichikov! Chichikov!
Where's he heading? Where's he going?
I don't know.
That's it, Cellophane! That's it! Faster! Faster! Yes! Onward! Onward! We're flying now! We're flying! Rolled like air beneath us! Surely we are a thing of heaven! We are history itself! We are light! The whirlwind power of the mighty horse! Hooves barely touch the earth! The reins jangling! The air thundering! The carriage a thing of smoke and fire! Make way, Earth! Make way!
But now his carriage is clattering without direction, blindly through the driving rain. In a night so dark that the coachman can't see the end of his whip. The fields stretch out for miles on either side. The mountains scrape angrily at the distant skies. I told other stories. Overcoats, noses, government inspectors. Sometimes in those stories, I'd see a carriage, blinds down, cloud of dust. Did I put it there? I don't know. Some say the carriage passed through the plains of Russia for another 20 years. Some say it was another 60. Others say it drives there yet. But of its inhabitant, there was never any sign. Only the leather blinds drawn down, the thump of a stick on the carriage roof, and an old coachman making dark slashes on the backs of the four thin and ghost-grey horses.
Dead Souls. The narrator was played by Michael Palin and Chichikov by Mark Heap. Tentetnikov was played by Toby Haydock, Kashkariov by Wiley Longmore, Cellophane and Chief of Police by Graham Hawley, Kostanzhoglo by David Fleischman. Korobotchka was played by Judith Davis and Ulinka by Rena Mahoney. Sound design was by Steve Brook. Dead Souls was written by Nikolai Gogol, dramatised by Dan Robolato and directed in Manchester by Polly Thomas.